My name is Ashleigh Palombi, and I'm speaking to you about the use of ultrasound therapy to treat ankle injuries and the evidence-based research that is presently available on this topic. Ankle injuries are arguably the most commonly injured body part in sport, and as sport in Australia is something of a nationwide obsession, there is good reason to research the current treatment modalities that surround ankle injuries. Australian sporting stars such as Tim Cahill, Sally Pearson and Leighton Hewitt have each been affected by some sort of ankle injury in varying degrees of severity across their career, and it is therefore important to understand how these ankle injuries can be potentially treated, as keeping these sporting stars competing in their respective sports is integral to Australian culture. Aside from sport, the ankle is obviously an integral structure in an individual's gait. It essentially acts as a lever, allowing for movement of the body over the foot and therefore propelling the individual forward. Gait is part of day-to-day life, and therefore if the ankle injuries are sustained, then this process could be significantly affected. The treatment modalities that surround this injury type are very interesting and worth researching to determine the most clinically effective type. Ultrasound therapy is of particular interest, as there are many theories that surround ultrasounds. Functionality and effectiveness. It is an ultrasonic procedure that uses very high frequency sound waves to stimulate the tissue beneath the skin in hope of speeding up the healing process while decreasing swelling, stiffness and pain at the injury site. These specific outcome measures are very important in physiotherapy, and as the ankle injury is such a common injury in society, the current literature available will be discussed to determine the use of ultrasound for therapeutic benefit. The search strategy that was used to retrieve the literature was based on the NHMRC evidence hierarchy, whereby the articles that were prioritised came from the level 1 evidence bracket, meaning that they were systematic reviews of RCTs. The databases searched included Cochrane, which is the gold standard in terms of literature, EBSCOhost, PubMed, Medline and Elsevier. And within these databases, articles were distinguished through basic inclusion and exclusion criteria. If the articles were specific to the treatment modality of ultrasound, then they were included. If they were relevant to ankle injuries, they were included. If they were recently published, so within a 5 to 8 year range, then they were included. If they were RCTs, may it be the review of several RCTs or a singular RCT, then they were included. If they were focused on generalized treatment modalities for ankle injuries though, they were excluded. And if they had co-interventions, they were also excluded. Throughout the search, it became clear that the amount of evidence on this topic that was particularly recent was scarce. A lot of dated studies were available, but since physiotherapy is an ever-changing practice with new research justifying new interventions all the time, the most recent evidence is required. The articles that were found and will be critically analysed certainly vary in quality. Venden Beckerham et al.'s article titled Therapeutic Ultrasound for Acute Ankle Sprains and Shanks et al.'s article titled The Effectiveness of Therapeutic Ultrasound for Musculoskeletal Conditions of the Lower Limb are both level 1 pieces of evidence, as they are systematic reviews of current available RCTs. This level 1 classification means that these pieces of evidence have the highest quality, statistical precision, size of effect and relevance in accordance with the specific study question and other studies in this field. But comparatively, Yerav et al.'s article titled Role of Ultrasound Therapy in the Healing of Stress Fractures is a level 2 piece of evidence in the NHMRC evidence hierarchy, as it is a double-blinded placebo RCT. Vanden Beckerham's et al.'s article is of the highest quality, coming from the Cochrane database, meaning that it has met all of its strict inclusion and exclusion criteria. It is a systematic review of 6 RCTs that each demonstrate the effect of true ultrasound therapy compared to placebo ultrasound therapy. The review itself's main inclusion criteria was the study's main outcome measures having to be pain, swelling, functional disability, and range of motion, with the main exclusion criteria being co-intervention, which would mean that the results were not indicative of ultrasound therapy alone. Shank et al.'s article, also deemed level 1 evidence, reviews 10 RCTs that focus on ultrasound therapy of the lower limb in general, with 6 of these being specific to the ankle, making it the most comprehensively studied injury type. Now, this is perhaps due to and aligns with the significant number of injuries sustained to this region. In the reviewed RCTs for the ankle, at least one group must have received true ultrasound therapy compared with placebo ultrasound therapy. And the outcome measures of this study were consistent with those discussed in Vanden-Beckeram's. The most clearly defined and reasonable exclusion criteria of this study was if a patient presented as asymptomatic, as then the relevant outcomes could not be measured and statistical significance could not be deduced. Yet Abbott-El's article, the double-blinded RCT, compares the effect of true ultrasound therapy in one group to placebo ultrasound therapy in another group on stress fracture injuries of the ankle. Despite the study purpose being clear and the intervention being clinically applicable, the sample size of 67 and select military demographic reduces the quality and relevance of the evidence, as the study is not truly reflective of general population and therefore general scope of ankle injuries. It is very clear that across all three of the studies discussed, there are significant differences. But what is a significant common factor in the sources is the sources of bias. Generally speaking, the risk of bias is a determining factor in the quality of evidence. And therefore, if the risk of bias is too great, the quality of evidence will be diminished. In the three articles discussed, the main risk of bias is the lack of blinding. This is nearly always a limiting feature in physiotherapy, as it is difficult to blind the practical application of interventions. And despite ultrasound being conducted through a machine, in all three studies, there was a lack of blinding of the care providers, and therefore the potential for the results to be skewed was definitely increased. Another major risk of bias was the use of the VAS pain scale in all three studies as the main outcome measure. Each individual has a different pain tolerance, and so using the VAS scale, a very subjective measure, as the primary outcome of a study puts it at risk of inconsistent results despite the consistency of the intervention application. The most prominent risk of bias, though, and a risk of bias that is prevalently seen in evidence-based health research, is the lack of methodology given in each article. According to the NHMRC, the methodological quality of each included study is critically appraised, and therefore, if this methodology is not given, then the likelihood of bias and confounding factors cannot be known, questioning the statistical precision and, more importantly, the quality of the evidence presented. Now, in conclusion, all of the discussed factors, you may be asking, is ultrasound therapy beneficial in the treatment of ankle injuries or not? The level 2 piece of evidence says yes, the level of improvement in pain and thus recovery from an ankle injury is statistically significant when using ultrasound therapy. But as outlined, there are a lot of limitations that surround this study methodology, population and setting. More specifically, it is clear that the relevance of evidence, the statistical precision of the evidence, and the quality of evidence in this study are all questionable. The two systematic reviews that are the level 1 pieces of evidence conversely found that there was no statistically significant benefit when using ultrasound therapy to treat ankle injuries. And therefore, it is nearly safe to say that due to these studies' statistical precision, relevance of evidence, reduced risk of bias, and overall quality of evidence, ultrasound therapy is not an effective intervention for ankle injuries. From this review, it is clear that more evidence on this intervention is necessary, particularly in the form of RCTs and then systematic reviews of these RCTs. The main lessons that can be taken away from this literature review is that by increasing the research in this field, more concise and definitive conclusions can be made on the intervention effects. For now, though, based on the research that is available, in response to an ankle injury, treatment modalities other than ultrasound therapy should be sought out in order to enable the best possible chance of clinical recovery. Several studies have indicated that initial rest and then functional rehabilitation is the best possible intervention for general ankle injuries, with more specific modalities given to more specific structural injuries. Functional rehabilitation will enable the patient to regain range of motion, regain control and regain strength, which in turn will enable them to return to activity if applicable, but more importantly, it will enable them to function and participate in daily life to their full capacity, hopefully without pain or restriction. Thank you very much for listening, and I hope this has helped you.